we leave it for the very end, then it's gonna be probably too much. So any kind of, you know, intervention you might have, or speakers.
Conversations,
yeah.
Maybe we can move on.
Private teaching. Mm-hmm. No, I just had a super short comment about Katya's super fascinating lecture, but this thing that in Russia permanently you have this vibe of this European grandeur, but you hyperbolize it. It's like city of St. Petersburg. It was built to mimic Europe, but they mimic pieces of Amsterdam or pieces of Paris, but 10 times bigger. So somehow, you know, to make Europe even more, you know, efficient, better, you know, than it was, and probably it comes somehow in Sochi, this image that you showed.
Better, but bigger, yes.
Hyperbolized.
I had to make a comment because I was criticized rightly so. But yes, there are some artists, of course, including Slavs and Tatars, who explore precisely this point where I said that there are no artists. I mean, there are no artists in Russia right now that will be working on this. Probably to reflect on that, we have to go outside. So I'm very much looking forward to the
presentation. I think it was very pertinent when you said that you had these conversations, you remember these conversations about divisions in Europe back from Moscow, because actually this is a part of a good old materialist Marxist tradition, historiography, that was completely wiped out during the 90s, right? And it was not unique to Russia, because Perry Anderson is following exactly the same line of analysis in his books about the Middle Ages and feudalism, etc. So I think this is a part of the conceptual tools that we need to reconstitute and rediscover, because also very materialist problems Andrzej was talking about, right, about the exclusion, the poverty, oppression, etc. It really requires a more materialistic approach, not against symbolic analysis, but to complement. We need both approaches to understand what's going on. Okay, so let's get to the second part, and our first speaker will be Monika Bobako, who is a philosopher from Adam Mickiewicz University in Poznań, and she's going to talk about peripheral Islamophobies and, of course, the refugees crisis, refugees problem is going to somehow be included. So please, Monika, the floor is yours.
The title of my presentation is Semi-Peripheral Islamophobies, Immigration.
Sorry, maybe some of you, because we have now more space here, maybe some of you want to move closer. As we don't have a microphone, I understand at the end of the room it may be a little bit loud enough. Huh? If we have three, we have four, please get one more. Okay, sorry.
So as we are exploring this aspect of Polish history and Polish identity that is somehow linked, like we are focusing mainly on this colonizing aspect of Polish history and identity, whereas what we emphasize and was said before, mainly this figure of being a victim as Poles. I want to, obviously, what is crucial here is to be aware of the fact that we are both colonized and colonizer. We are somewhere in between. And what is very important is this story about semi-peripherality of Poland and this special positioning within Europe that was described very nicely by Janek at the beginning. I wanted to talk about Islamophobia in Poland, which is a special phenomenon because it is Islamophobia about Muslims. So in my opinion, Islamophobia can be analyzed as a special field, as a special phenomenon that shows very in detail how this special semi-peripheral position of colonizer and of the colonizing force is somehow visible. We got this Islamophobia about Muslims, so obviously we, as we know from the huge scholarship on xenophobia, that all kinds of xenophobic attitudes are as much a way of relating towards others of some community as it is an instrument of regulating power relations, identity issues within the community. So, you know, those images of the others are also kind of projections that serve some internal purposes. That's pretty obvious thing that we know about xenophobia. So in case of Polish Islamophobia, we can see that very clearly. Well, the starting point of my analysis of Islamophobia, I mean, because I just finished the book on this topic, however, the Polish issues are just part of the discussion in the book. But the starting point of my analysis of Islamophobia is the fact that it can be a part of a very different political discourses. Islamophobia is a very diversified phenomenon. It starts from very different premises. It caters for very different fears, tensions, identity needs, etc., etc. So you can clearly see that on the one hand, we've got this right-wing, Christian conservative, nationalist Islamophobia that is operating with this concept of pure Christian or European or national identity, and Muslims are the others who contaminate this purity. That's pretty clear. This one, one current of Islamophobic discourses. But on the other hand, we've got also and I call this branch of Islamophobia conservative Islamophobia. But on the other hand, we've got totally different Islamophobic discourses that I call progressivist Islamophobia that starts from totally different premises. These are the liberal positions or leftist or atheist positions that actually claim that Islam is something, is an opposition of European values understood not, I mean, not about, it's not a talk about heritage, identity, past, etc., but this is talk about principles, individual rights, democracy, human rights, autonomy, sexual freedom, etc., etc. So then you will have this kind of discourse, which is starting from different premises, but still remains anti-Muslim. However, it is somehow part of totally different like political aesthetics. So obviously you can see, and well, this is the whole spectrum of the arguments, yeah? And sometimes the arguments are somehow moving from one side of this political spectrum to the other. You can observe it in greater detail. And you can see this kind of structure of Islamophobic discourses in all places in Europe. But my thesis, my observation is that in Polish case, they've got a special framing and special sources. What is important, I think, is to be aware of the fact that, I mean, Islamophobia is operating with the concept of Islam and Europe that actually function as empty signifiers. Depending on what kind of, what kind of political discourse is actually appropriating these Islamophobic arguments, Europe will mean something different, you know, threatened Europe, Europe which is to be invaded by Muslims, you know, Europe that must defend itself, etc., etc. So Europe may be understood in very different ways, and Islam as something threatening, as something alien, as something which is clashing with Europe, will be also filled with completely different meanings, depending on the political context. So if you take this progressivist Islamophobia, you see that Europe is secularism, gender identity, gender equality, sexual freedom, human rights, etc., democracy. Islam is total opposition. It's like no democracy, no human rights, total religious authority, oppression, etc. Yeah? So this kind of discourse, that's why we have to defend Europe. If you take this, if you take conservative Islamophobic narratives, this talk about Europe is more complex, because on the one hand, this is all about heritage, Christian tradition, Roman law, Greek philosophy, whatever, nationalist identities, etc., etc. So Europe is somehow defined in this conservative way. Obviously, Islam is against it. However, there is many complex issues when you think about the issue of religion, for example. this conservative narrative about defending Christian Europe is not about secularism, it's like about two competing religious universums, if I can say that. Yeah, it's a special story. But so this is this ideal account of what is European, using the identity issues, history, heritage, Christianity, etc., etc. However, current state, there is another vision of Europe, which is Europe in its current state. It is a Europe in decline, Europe completely corrupted by the ideas of multiculturalism, by feminism, by gender equality, which is Europe, politically correct Europe, which is inviting Muslims, which is actually destroying what is truly European, etc., etc. So this Europe, which is feminist, multiculturalist, politically correct, is actually doing everything which is actually creating the situation in which Muslims can come. And this kind of Europe, liberal, progressive, politically correct, is guilty of creating this threat, this Islamic threat. So we've got this kind of these two Europes. Obviously, this kind of argument you can find in all European Islamophobic discourses. In Polish context, they have their special variants. And in my opinion, how they function, especially in the context of the lack of Muslim population, virtual lack of Muslim community in Poland, is it is linked with semi-peripheral position of Poland in both senses. One is symbolic, and I mean here the way Poland is inserted in the very concept of Europe, symbolically. I mean all those problems that we have had about do we really belong to Europe, are we truly European, are we just aspiring to being Europe, what does it mean to be Polish and European, you know, this kind of things that are somehow linked with this post-transformation discourse of returning to Europe. And so that's one story. So this symbolic dimension of us being in Europe, that's one thing. Another issue refers to what Jacek was actually saying, this semi-peripheral position of Poland within Europe in economic terms, that we are mainly this assembly plant now for foreign companies, that we are a reservoir for cheap labor. We are a country which sends immigrants to Britain and other countries because we are